Welcome back, companions. This is chapter 3 of my book, Phaethon's Legacy. If you want to start at the beginning, check the annotated card in the top right. If you want a refresher on what happened last time, check the description box down below. Let's get started, shall we? March 10th, American Union, Chicago. Gregory Thompson awoke to the annoying chirp of his cell phone. For just a moment, he thought of his bedroom as it had formerly been, his father's room. The second burst of noise from his phone brought him back to the present. He seriously considered ignoring it and would have if not for the ringtone he used exclusively for work numbers. He picked it off the bedside table and said, "Hello?" Tony's too cheery voice came through. "Hey there, Greg." After waiting for a beat, Greg asked, "What's up?" Tony said, "I need off tonight, and Mr. Stevens said I have to find someone to fill in." Greg said, "I'm sick." Tony said, "Come on, it's been 2 days. No one else can come in." Greg searched the ceiling for a good reply, but only found the light fixture. He rubbed sleep crust from his eye as Tony continued, "Come on, man. I've got tickets to the game tonight. You remember Denise? That blonde at McGinnis's a few weeks ago? Don't you? She already agreed to go with me." Greg pressed a hand against the left side of his ribs. The pain this morning was bearable. Finally, he said, "All right, I'll fill in." Tony said, "Thanks, buddy. I knew you wouldn't let me down." Greg said, "Sure." They hung up, and Greg called Mr. Stevens to confirm the switch. He got up and examined himself in the bedroom mirror, decided he needed a shave. Lifting his shirt, he saw the bruising around 4 circular scars had started to yellow. The memory of being shot felt surreal, like it had happened to someone else. Lugging car parts around the factory tonight would be a chore, but Greg supposed one more day off wouldn't have done much to help. He made his way to the kitchen where he poured a glass of orange soda, using it to wash down vitamins and a caffeine pill. Greg was alone in the house. His brother Corey would be at university, and his sister Samantha was, well, somewhere. Greg didn't know. He was starting to worry that her graduating high school a semester early had been a bad decision. After he took a shower and got dressed, he returned to the kitchen to pour a bowl of cereal. Greg made his way to the living room to check his email, but before he sat down, there was a knock on the front door. He paused, rubbing his thumb and forefinger together while thinking of several possibilities. Looking out of the peephole, Greg saw a man and woman who were dressed in casual clothing. Greg felt relief, and it took him a moment to realize why. He had feared seeing men in full tactical armor, officers ready to blackbag him for a murder, even if it was in self-defense. He took a steadying breath while a cramp of tensions slowly released its hold on his guts. The woman reached out and rang the doorbell. They could be the faithful. Corey had talked about a new chapter house in the city. Their missionaries littered the university campus with both their pamphlets and their presence. What would possess people to worship that thing, Phaethon? Greg waited a moment and then unlocked the door, opening it. The pair appeared to be in their mid-20s, close to his own age. The woman had curly auburn hair and wore a muted green dress. The man had straight black hair and wore a loose-fitting blue shirt with khaki pants. After a brief pause, Greg asked, "Hello?" The woman said, "My name is Talia Lamarck, and this is Joe Yasso Lamarck. We're here on behalf of the Lamarck Family Foundation, and we would like to talk to you and your family." Greg thought her accent sounded northern, maybe Canadian. He gave a placating smile. "We're not interested in changing religions." The smile Talia gave in return eased Greg's tensions a bit. It seemed genuine. "That's not what we're about. The Lamarck family provides a humanitarian service for certain groups of people." Greg said, "I've never heard of you." Talia made an encompassing gesture. We have discretion for the sensitive nature of the people we help. Greg's apprehension began to return. So what are you doing at my door? Tally's smile grew in warmth. We know that sometimes people feel isolated and don't know how to ask for help or who to ask when they need it. Greg said, we don't need any help. Talia said, the Lomark family likes to extend its affiliations to gifted people so we can all prosper. Greg could feel his face heating up. I don't know what you mean. Talia quirked an eyebrow. Is that so? It was a pleasure meeting you, Gregory. We'll be in touch. Joyoso nodded to Greg and the two walked off. As he closed the door, he realized that he had never given the pair his name. He switched the lock into place, then moved to look through the blinds, watching them leave. Checking his watch, he saw that it was almost 2 o'clock. If he didn't head out in a few minutes, he would be late for his shift at the factory. Damn it, Tony. He needed to talk about these Lamarcks with his brother and sister in person. He also needed his job. Beyond his father's life insurance, he was the only person paying the bills. After getting ready and leaving a note for his siblings, Greg looked out the window again. There was a man walking down the street smoking a cigarette who glanced at Greg's house. Greg didn't see any sign of those strange Lamarck people. He locked the door on his way out to the garage and got in his car. As he pulled out of the driveway, he paused for a moment and really considered calling in sick. He looked at the dashboard clock, sighed, and continued on his way to work. The end of chapter 3. Give a like and subscribe, companions, to find out what happens next time. See you then.